right now. All right, so again, thank you everyone for joining us for today. Again, as a reminder, if you just joined us, please turn your cameras on. You will be on mute during the presentation. I'm Miriam Green, Director of Marketing and Alumni Affairs at American Friends of the Hebrew University. Thank you for joining us for the Hebrew University Alumni Association's Torch Talks event today. The HU Alumni Association seeks to engage all Hebrew University alumni in the United States, and in this case around the world, to foster a lifelong connection to the university and to connect fellow alumni around the country. And again, in this case around the world. And even before we were all social distancing, we have been and will continue to have these talks and more as a way to continue to bring our alumni community and friends together. There are many ways you can get involved with us, from participating in future events, attending or hosting an event when we can all be together in person again, which is hopefully very soon, sharing your alumni story and photos with us, telling us when you have a job opening to put on our alumni job board, and giving to the Alumni Annual Fund, which supports scholarships for Hebrew University students, which is always needed. To learn more, please email alumni@afhu.org. We have several great upcoming virtual events, including two Torch Talks. The next one will be on April 6th at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time as we travel to China to learn about Jewish merchants on the ancient Silk Road. Our last Torch Talks of the spring lineup will occur on April 12th at 1 p.m. Eastern Time and will be Food Fights, When Scientists, Advocates, and Politicians Set the Table. So if we all want to promote health and fight obesity, how do we get from knowledge to action, and what are the barriers of policy level? Registration links for these will be put in the chat box during today's presentation. To learn more about these events and others, as well as registering, please visit afhu.org/events. And I think today's presentation will be music to your ears and brain. Everyone, again, will be on mute during the presentation, but we will be taking questions at the end. To submit a question, please type it in the chat box and we'll do our best to get to as many as possible. I'm now pleased to introduce Hebrew University professors Roni Granot and Ellie Nelken. Roni Granot is an associate professor in the Department of Musicology at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. At the center of her research are questions related to our emotional and cognitive responses to music and the relationship between these processes and music theory. Other research interests include music, space, and motion, genetic aspects of musical memory, the human voice and out-of-tune singing, which I know nothing about because I have perfect pitch, and the perception of consonants and dissonance in Western versus Arab listeners. More recently, she conducted a multinational study spanning 12 countries in an attempt to understand the role of music in coping with emotional and social challenges imposed by the COVID-19 crisis. Her papers have been published in Frontiers in Psychology, Neuropsychologia, Neuro Report, Music Perception, New Music Research, and more. Now, Professor Nelken. Following his undergraduate studies in physics and mathematics, he switched his interest to neuroscience, which I think works out well for us today. He finished his PhD in 1991, followed by a postdoc at Johns Hopkins University, and returned to the Hebrew University as a faculty member since 1994. Since 2008, Professor Nelken, has been a professor and is currently director of the Edmund and Lilly Soffer Center for Brain Sciences, jointly with Professor Adim Mizrahi. He's interested in the coding and complex sounds by neural activity and studied in depth the coding and surprising sounds in the ascending auditory system. Professors, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Good evening to everyone. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me well? Okay. So it's a pleasure to be here. It's an honor to present this double feature with Roni Granot. We've been loosely collaborating for many years now. So, what are emotions? Okay, in order to answer this question, I want to start actually with trying to shortly address the other question, what is not emotions? Okay, so when we are trying to think about things that are not emotions and that involve the brain, okay, that the thing that usually comes up to mind are things that are called cognition, okay? That's the wheels in the brain that are turning and that are making logical deductions and considering data and so on and so forth. When we talk about brain, we usually think about cognitive functions. Here are some of the areas of cognition, okay, that are considered as cognitive functions: attention and memory, intelligence, all kind of things like that. Okay, when we think about emotions, okay, there's something else. There's a different flavor to the things that we call emotions. I mean, one thing that's very clear in contrasting the previous illustration and this one is the fact that there are no words here. Okay, the emotions are conveyed by, here in this case, the emojis. Okay, there's something that's not entirely entirely verbal when we talk about emotions. Okay, even when we try to conceptualize exactly what emotions are, okay, you see here two kinds of illustrations, attempts to illustrate the richness and structure of the emotional world. We end up with all kinds of emotions that are similar to each other in some sense, that are dissimilar from each other in other senses. It's a sort of complicated, there's a complicated structure to the emotional world that is hard to capture in simple ways. So when you go to the literature and you try to see how emotions are defined in the neurobiological literature, it turns out again that they are hard to define. So here are I'm going to show you three definitions that I found in papers that attempt to deal with the question of what emotions are and how the brain processes emotions. So here's one of them. Edmond Rolls was a pioneer in the study of high order visual perceptual areas. And this is his definition of emotion. Emotions are states elicited by rewards and punishers. Okay, problem with this is that this is not a definition, it's a description. Okay, it still doesn't tell you what emotions are. So here's another one.
Hold on one second, Ellie. I think you just broke up just a little bit. Are you there?
Okay.
Yeah, we hear you now. Okay.
Okay, sorry. So emotions are involved in the conscious or unconscious evaluation of events. Okay, so there's a sense that emotions have a valence. Okay, I think that Roni will mention that later. And that the third definition is actually, for me as a neuroscientist, is a somewhat better one. Emotions, so this comes from Antonio Damasio. Emotions are pre-programmed set of coordinated bodily reactions with adaptive values. Okay, feelings are secondary. So what does Damasio try to say? Okay, emotions, something happened in the world and you react to it in a pre-programmed way. So there are things that are set in the brain to react, for example, fear to a snake or something like that, okay? Feeling here is the conscious side of the emotion, okay? So the conscious sense that you have an emotion in Damasio's view is actually secondary. It happens afterwards, okay? The emotion itself is a pre-programmed set of coordinated bodily reaction. Now, why is this good definition for me? Because it let me access the brain. So here's another attempt to define what emotions are. So emotions involve physiological activation, expressive behaviors, and conscious experience. This is the feeling. This is the conscious experience is the part that we call emotion. Okay? But actually emotion is richer. Okay, it involves also other things. So what does this mean? Okay, so this guy, you probably feels something, has some emotion. Okay, it's uncomfortable something. What you see when you look at his photo is the expressive behavior. Okay, it tries to convey in its behavior the fact that he is uncomfortable about something. Probably his conscious experience is unpleasant, but not too unpleasant, slightly unpleasant. Okay, and it's the kind of feeling. Okay, here's another example. Okay, happiness is related to faster heart rate. So this would be the physiological activation. Okay, smiling. Okay, that would be the expressive behavior and the conscious experience of happiness. Okay, that's the feeling. Now, these considerations are an entry point to brain mechanisms. Why? Because heart rate is controlled by the brain. Smiling is controlled by the brain. Okay, and I would suggest, okay, you can make
sorry, everyone, one second. Ellie, are you back? Are you there, Ellie? We hear you now.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry this happens. So this leads to the question of what part of the brains are activated by emotions. So when we look at the brain, we usually think about this huge sheet, external sheet, that is the thing that we usually consider as brain when we think about the brain. This is the cortex, the cerebral cortex, this external sheet, relatively thin sheet of neurons, okay, as the brain. But in fact, the brain has a lot of other parts. Okay, we call them subcortical stations. Okay, and it turns out that cognition is strongly related to things that happen in the cortex. Okay, but emotions very often have to do with parts of the brain that are subcortical. So there is a separation between bits of the brain that have to do with cognition and bits of brain that have to do with emotions. This is just an example. So this is an experiment that was run by Antonio Damasio, published about 20 years ago. And a few years later, the data was reanalyzed by Panksepp and his people. And what they did was to count the number of brain areas that were that showed increased activation when people were sad, okay, or felt sadness. And how many cortical areas, okay, this showed increased activation. So it turned out that very few cortical areas were activated during the feeling of sadness, but a lot of subcortical areas were showed increased activation in sadness. Okay, they also looked at areas that showed decreased activation, and there the situation was the opposite. So when you feel sadness, you inactivate a lot of your cortex, the part that has to do with cognition, and you activate a lot of subcortical areas. And it turned out that this is general. Okay, so they looked also at happiness and anger and fear. And for all of these emotions, it seemed like most of the areas that were activated during the feeling, okay, during the while people were sad or happy or angry or fearful, were subcortical, whereas cortical areas tended to get inactivated. So the emotional brain is mostly subcortical. Okay, it turns out that it's relatively primitive. It's evolutionary conserved in mammals, and even some parts of it can be recognized in vertebrates that are not mammals. These are parts of the brain that tend to be fast and automatic. So something happens in the world and they get activated relatively fast and without awareness. Okay, the emotional brain is balanced. The emotions are balanced. They can be good or bad. And it's a large part of it, not all of it, but a large part of it is unaware. This notion of Damasio, that the feeling, the conscious side is secondary. It happens after the emotional brain got activated, and sometimes the emotional brain wants to send up information to the consciousness. To summarize this part, this discussion of the emotional brain, I want to again to emphasize emotions are in the brain, okay? The feelings, the conscious side of the emotion is the tip of the iceberg. There's a huge amount of emotional processing that does not reach consciousness. Different brain areas tend to be involved in cognition and emotions, and emotion involve a lot of subcortical activity. And I'm going to let Roni continue from here.
Hello, everyone. I hope you can hear me okay. Good. I want to begin with a piece of music. And this is a well-known piece by Rachmaninoff, written originally in 1915. It's called Vocalise. So something, a piece for voice without words. It's well known, I think some of you may know it. Here it's performed in an adaptation, one of many adaptations to a solo instrument, in this case, cello, a cello rendition. And I would very much ask you and like, for those of you who are willing, to share with us using the chat, what do you feel while listening to this piece? So just please use short sentences, single words, so we can all follow what you're writing. And this is about a minute or a minute and a half. Okay, I'm sorry to interrupt this beautiful music. I hope you could sort of skim through the words coming in. And I think you can agree with me that there were very few words related to simple emotions like happy, sad, anger, fear. Even the sadness was not entirely sadness, but there was calm and tender, and many, many other words. And if Ellie said that it's difficult to define emotions, let me tell you and Ellie that to define what our music evoked emotions, this is difficult. at least in our experience, it doesn't feel like these words really describe the experience. It seems that the experience is much richer, much more dynamic. And one question that we may ask is, are these feelings the same as everyday emotions? If I say I feel sadness while listening to music, is it the same sadness that I feel when I lose someone or anything like that? From one side, there are no real events. Nothing happens, so why should I be sad? There's no adaptive value, so there's no correct or incorrect response that is going to enhance my survival. There is physical activation, physiological activation, changes in heart rate, in blood pressure, in hormones, in neurohormones, in neurotransmitters, but it's not specific to any emotions associated with the music. It's much more general and very inconsistent in terms of within the same person, across people, etc. There is reward. Ellie mentioned rewards and punishers. Yes, we feel pleasure. And as Ellie will show you, there is a much activation in the reward systems of the brain. And there is expressive behavior. We may change our facial gestures, body gestures, but not always, and certainly not universal, like it's been contended for basic emotions. So on the one hand, there are some effects, there are some behaviors or phenomena that are similar to regular emotions, and others are not. Ellie mentioned that much of what's going on is subconscious or non-conscious, and that's very consistent with music. Some other people have said it much better than the way I could. Music begins where words leave off. There's no way I can describe the musical experience or music itself, or else I wouldn't need it. I would just use words. Musical experience is most often pre or non-verbal, and it's very physical. And I think all of this makes it a good candidate to talk, crosstalk with Ellie's ideas of the primitive or subcortical brain. But I also want to make a point that what I've been talking about sort of detaches music from context. Recall that people could not listen to music for many millennia, probably until the last 100 years or so, without making music. It was not an option at all. And it was mostly by making music together. That's what I'm calling musicking. So it is a social behavior. And when I say there is no context, there is no adaptive value, etc., that's not really true if we look at the music in its more holistic form. And there are some very prominent hypotheses about music or some form of pre-music, proto-music being a common ancestor for language. And it is very relevant to language acquisition. I can't describe it now, but I just want to make the point that really music should be thought of as being in context. Now, I'm looking at my watch and I see we're sort of running short in time. I'm not going to show this video. Some of you may want to look at it later. What it shows is a group of hunter-gatherers from the Akapigmis in Cameroon, West Africa, a group of women walking in the forest, singing to themselves, the nature, the trees. And you can relate to it yourself, what I mean music in context as opposed to thinking about music in a very detached manner. So it's decided that it wants to play, but I'm not going to let it play just in favor of time. So really, I think one way to think about this thing is to ask if the context And that includes the human voice, the words, the visual information, the context, the function that music plays, like wedding songs or music while you march, etc. This may give you the specific emotion, and music then has another task, which is to amplify and enrich whatever is offered by the other media. And still we have this unique case of instrumental music, which we ask ourselves, how does it evoke emotions? So if I focus for one moment on the bigger picture here, I can say that maybe we do not need music to provide very specific emotions, but rather provide something more general that Ellie talked about a bit. And this is another model trying to organize emotions using only two dimensions. One of valence, I will call it pleasantness. If I feel, if I'm in a pleasant situation or unpleasant one, and arousal, how sleepy or aroused I am. And in fact, by positioning ourselves each moment in the world in terms of these two dimensions, we have a very vague notion of how we feel, even pre-emotion, but it gives us a pretty good idea once we can measure or tell ourselves, yes, this is pleasant, and yes, I'm aroused, I can say, okay, I'm probably excited. Or I'm aroused, but I feel very bad. It must be something of the negative sort. Now, music is very, very good at changing arousal and pretty good at changing valence. And if it does that, then maybe it can serve as a background for enriching and increasing other emotions. So what I'm going to do in the next few minutes that I have before I hand over the talk back to Ellie is to present one sort of theory that offers not a single way, but many ways to do the next thing. So I want to talk about arousal and valence as the very basic level from which to start. And then we should ask, how does music change arousal and valence? And what are the necessary mechanisms to move from this level to another level, which some of it may be preconscious, some of it may be verbal and conscious, maybe looking at basic emotions and more complex emotions like melancholy, and maybe some music specific or art specific emotions, aesthetic emotions, I will talk about a bit later. So I will come back to this figure in my last slide or so. And so the mechanisms that help us understand how music changes arousal and valence and how it helps us transform our experience from this very vague realm into something more specific is one possible model is proposed by Patrick Jusslin from Uppsala in Sweden. And its acronym is Brechwemme model. Ellie will talk about some of these mechanisms, so I will just name them here, and others I will give a few details. So brainstem reflex, sounds associated with danger, so music can present very loud, very sudden, maybe rough, and maybe low-pitched tones that may remind us of sounds associated with danger. Rhythmic entrainment, music's ability to get us moving to the beat. I will present a few words about that later. Conditioning, evaluative conditioning, where music is paired with positive or negative emotions. Ellie will talk about this soon. Emotional contagion is interesting in the sense that it taps into the mechanisms that enable us to feel empathy and even pain when we see someone else getting a blow, even though we're not getting anything physical, we may feel the pain. And specifically for music, I want to emphasize that music uses the same vocal apparatus as speech, and much of the cues that are used in music are taken from the ways we express emotion in speech. For example, a sad utterance would include a low pitch, very slow speech, descending lines, and a restricted range of pitches. And musicians will pick up on that in order to evoke sadness. Visual imagery can be very concrete, like when you associate the music with the movie that you saw and you immediately see the pictures coming up, but it could also be very abstract and in that sense, idiosyncratic. In parentheses, let me tell you that there's nearly no fMRI study of brain scanning while you listen to music that does not show activation of the visual cortex, and that's very interesting. Some of it is more common, like in the interesting association between low pitches associated with dark tones, dark colors, as compared to high tones associated with bright colors. Episodic memory is simply related to all these nostalgic feelings that we have from music, which brings back to us places and people that we remember through the music. And as we saw in our last study on the corona, on usage of music during the lockdown, this is an important mechanism to help us cope with the stress that this situation has brought. Ellie will talk about musical expectancy, and I will then later talk about aesthetic evaluation. So I hand back to you, Ellie, the presentation.
Okay. I want to talk about the requirements and a simple model for how music can evoke emotions. So sounds have to reach the ears, and then they evoke activity in the auditory system, and then the something in the auditory system causes activity in the emotional brain. Now, it cannot be otherwise, okay? Because there's no other access of auditory information into the emotional brain. Okay, so one feature of the activity in the auditory system that can cause activity in the emotional brain is simply the strength of the activity. Okay, so a simple model for musical emotion in the brain will look like this. Okay, if I have something that evoke only a low activity in the auditory system, this is not enough to open this narrow passage into the emotional brain. However, if I do something to the sounds that will cause a much larger activity in the auditory system, then this passage from the auditory to the emotional brain will open and will get an activity in the emotional brain. It will go up and down and do all kinds of things. Eventually it will die off. Okay, and this is one way by which music can evoke emotions. Okay, so what I want to show you is that at least some of these ways that Roni described for music to access emotions, to cause emotions, are actually compatible with this model. So I'll start with loud sounds. Okay, this is what the model called brainstem reflexes, the first way. Okay, now loud sounds, we know that loud sounds cause high activity in the auditory system. There's nothing surprising about this. So there's a boom and we jump and we are fearful. Okay, so this is really simple. Okay, something that's a bit more subtle is the issue of surprises. So a lot of my musical expectancy, a lot of my scientific life is spent studying the responses to surprising sounds in the auditory system. And we evoke surprise very simply. We use a sequence of tones, of sounds. Okay, one of them occurs a lot, so it's expected, and the other one is rare, so it's unexpected. Okay, this is all. And then we can put electrode into the brain tissue and record electricity. So I will not explain to you exactly what these signals are. These are recording inside the neuron in the auditory cortex of a rat. But The thing, what you see here in the blue line is the amount of electricity that happens in this neuron when it listens to the common sound. And in red, the amount of electricity that happens in this neuron when it listens to the rare sound. And the rare sound evoke larger activity. Now, this could be simply because this neuron likes the rare sound more. Okay, so what we do is present the same sequence, the same sounds, but reversing the roles of the two sounds. So now the one that was common is rare, and the one that was rare is common. And we record again the activity of the same neuron to the to this second sequence. Okay, and when we compare responses, we always compare responses to the same sound in one case when it was rare and in the other case when it was common. And we can see almost invariably, I mean, this is an extremely robust result, that responses to surprising sounds, to sounds that are unexpected, is larger than the responses to the same sounds when they are expected. Okay, so surprises also can breach this wall between the auditory system and the emotional brain. And finally, the last example in which we understand pretty well the mechanism that I want to discuss is this evaluative conditioning. Okay, you associate a sound with something that evokes an emotion. Okay, the way that we do it with animals usually is we evoke fear in them because it's very easy to make a mouse or a rat fearful. Okay, so we put a rat in this case in a box. Okay, and we present the rat.
Hold on, Ellie, 1 second. You broke up again.
I'm back right. Again.
You're back.
So we present the sound and give the without a consequence, and we present a different sound. And when the CS plus sound is played, okay, we give a foot shock to the animal. And this happens about once per minute, relatively slowly. The animal experienced this a few times. And a few days later, we take the same rat, put it in a different box, and play to it the two sounds without shocks. And when the CS plus, the sound that was associated with the shock was played, the animal freezes. It shows fear responses. Okay, so this is very, again, a very robust result. It has been reproduced, studied in many labs. And as in many different labs, when we record electrical activity in the brain of these animals later, we see that the sounds that have been used for conditioning, the one that was associated with the foot shock, evoke larger responses after the conditioning. Okay, so the gray here is how much the sound, the activity evoked by the sound before conditioning, and the black is in the same animal after conditioning. Okay, now in this case, before fear conditioning, if this was a situation, actually we know that after fear conditioning, the access of the auditory system to the emotional brain is stronger, okay? This, it's not a narrow channel anymore, it becomes a wide channel, and it's relatively easy for the sound to evoke the emotional response. So this is the framework in which we work, in which we try to explain emotion in the brain. And when we go to the details, okay, it turns out that this is correct, basically correct, but has a lot of components, a lot of different components. The auditory system is not a single station. There's a lot of stations of the auditory system. The emotional brain is not a single station. There's a lot of stations of the auditory system, of the emotional brain. Okay, there are also feedback connections. The emotional brain affects the auditory system back. Okay, and what we do, what we try to do, we and others who study this type of question, is to answer all of these questions. What are the connections? What types? How they form? Why they form? Under what conditions? To what extent they are genetically determined? To what extent they are experience dependent? And so on and so forth. Roni.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about two of the mechanisms we did not discuss. One, Ellie can tell you about a lot, but I will tell you a bit about it. It's called rhythmic entrainment, and it's our ability to synchronize with the musical beat. The musical beat is, of course, this recurring time period to which we respond with some physical activity, be it clapping, snapping, tapping, whatever you will. And it's a very uniquely human ability in the sense that even the few animals, there are a few types of animals that can synchronize to a musical beat, but they're doing it much less precisely than humans and much less automatically. In fact, if you've seen young toddlers, you might have seen them, I'm not saying dance to the music, but bounce to the music. And even infants of two days old have been shown to respond in their brain to the beat or to the non-beat in a series of beats. If you take out one beat, they will show a response to it. And it's important to note that the beat is not out there in the music. The music gives us enough cues, but often the cues will be in tones on the beat. Whenever there is a tone on the beat, it's very easy to identify the beat. And that's what happens when you have a bass drum, boom, 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 in much of today's music. But often there's no tone on the beat, or there are many tones on the beat, and yet we can still maintain the beat. And so it's important to note that the auditory system is extremely good at detecting temporal patterns. It's much better than the visual system in doing these things. It's always deals with these finding out regularities or cyclical patterns, identifying when things begin, when things end, not only short items, but also longer ones like words and sentences. And it has very vast connections with the motor system. And what we believe happens is that the music, the beats in there, create an oscillation or drive the rhythm activity of the auditory system, which then drives the oscillations of the motor activity, of the motor system, of the motor brain, and then through it to the motor system. And so maybe the best example is how music, or in fact beats, like in a metronome, help people with Parkinson to improve their gait. Music literally moves us. It activates our motor system, it creates activity in our motor neurons. And in this sense, it's a very physical sensation, and it's a very much one that creates in us arousal. It's not by chance that music that has strong rhythmic elements creates high arousal. So this is one mechanism, very interesting and music specific mechanism. The last mechanism I'll talk about is aesthetic judgment. So I was saying that it's difficult to think about emotions in music just using emotional words from daily life, because after all, despite what I've said, as music as a social behavior, at least nowadays, it is also art, and it was also art in previous times. I mean, even when they sing in the forest, it's singing in order to communicate with the spirits. And you cannot communicate with the spirits with language. It just wouldn't work. So of course there are some things like our attention to perceptual organization rules, like symmetry and proportion, maybe some judgment if it's in style, if it's original, but I'm not so much interested in that. I want to present another perspective, which actually comes from Eastern philosophy. And it's even not specific to art, but it's very much apt for art. So it says, I'm citing now, flavor beyond flavor expresses the idea of second order awareness of a first order sensory experience. Savoring is a self-initiated action of attending and absorbing. So when you listen to a piece of music or are looking at a piece of art, you're self-initiating an action of attending and absorbing. And just like when you taste a very good wine, it will be very unexpectedly if you swallow it immediately. What you will usually do is swirl it in your mouth and refrain from swallowing it. It's not the pleasure you're seeking, not the pleasure is in the savoring, is in really sensing all the flavors and aromas and being aware of doing such thing, being aware that you are now enjoying and immersing yourself in this activity, in this experience. And that is why I suggest what we try to show you in some form is how music can change arousal and valence. We use the Brachvema mechanisms to move to this level. And this second order consciousness of being conscious that you're immersing in the experience could be part of the feeling that it has some aesthetic value or emotions. And I'm going to rob the last 2 minutes by presenting a very famous piece called Dido's Lament from Dido's and Aeneas opera by Purcell, 17th century. And even though one cannot describe the music, I do want you to note some features in it. And you will tell me if it's akin to something I was talking to earlier. There are low pitches, it's slow. The pitch often goes down either slowly or by jumps. It has music specific elements like a minor key and dissonance. And please note the transition from one part to another when the actress calls, remember me, and so on. So the last 2 minutes.
Thank you.
I'm sorry to end with such a gloomy, but beautiful piece. So that's it.
All right. Thank you. Thank you both so much. Really, really fascinating. We are now gonna open up to questions. So again, if you have a question, please use the chat box and we'll get to as many as we can. We already have one that came in. And while we're waiting for others, I'm sharing the links to the two upcoming events we have. We'll include those in the recaps as well. So the first question that came in from Susan Hornstein, Jewish happy music is often in the minor key. Has anyone addressed how many factors, slow, low, minor, etc., must be present for music to evoke sadness?
I assume this is for me. That's a very good question. The minor key issue is really very hotly debated if it's cultural or not. What has been found is that the slow tempo, the descending intervals and small intervals are all found also in other sad musics in other parts of the world and in speech as well. For music, Jewish music, I don't know that there has been any study of that. And that's a great idea for research for me. Thank you.
All right, there you go. The next question comes from Paul. Is there a difference between neurological responses to listening to music and responses to making music? And then two other follow-up questions. And between listening to live music when you're in the audience of a live performance, like savoring it in public, and recorded music, and if you are listening to it with others or alone?
Well, the answers are yes, yes, and yes. I think the most obvious one is the difference between listening and performing music. When you perform music, you also move, okay? And there's a lot of intentions that have to do. You have to plan your movement in according to the music. Okay? If you play an instrument, you prepare. You need to prepare the movement much before you actually execute the emotion that will evoke the sound. Okay, so there's a huge difference in the brain activity, in the overall brain activity between listening to music and actually performing it. Whether this affects the activity in the auditory system is a question, is a research question. Okay, this is less clear. I think there's good evidence that it does. Okay, so the electrical activity in the auditory system itself is not the same when you hear and when you actually perform. But that's an active research subject. For the other two, live performance and whether in with others or not, the answer is sort of the same. When the activity in your brain is different because the environment is different. Everything, the sound is just one of a lot of sensory stimuli that are present in these situations. And so it's not necessarily surprising that the activity in the auditory brain itself is affected by these contexts where the music is played.
Okay. The next question is from Judith Tellerman. What is your reaction to a response to symphonic performance where the person is feeling the struggle and even in words, thinking the anguish of the composer, later reading that this is what the composer actually experienced, having been told to rewrite the piece many times?
We really think that there is a dissociation between what the composer felt and the output. I mean, there are many examples where composers were passing a terrible epoch in their life and they were composing sad music. But at the same time, there are as many examples as that they were composing happy music. So I think the interesting question is not so much what the composer meant, but what is it in the music, in the context, and in the listener that together sort of are able to transmit something. And that something has to be defined, has to be measured, has to be, usually we ask people what they feel. Unfortunately, we do that often with using closed options like a list of words of emotions. And once we see that there is commonality, we can go back and try to understand what musical features and what other personal components go into whatever was transmitted by the performer slash the composer, finally to the listener. But what the composer meant originally is, to my mind, less important.
Okay. So I know we only have a couple of minutes and a few more questions. Someone just commented, Vivian, about how much her grandson, who is 2 years old, how much he lights up when he hears music and the effect it has on him and his emotions. This one is from Renanda Dunowitz. I'm sorry if I said your name correctly. What is the importance of the culture background of the listener to specific music?
Well, you like what you know. Okay, so I think to a large extent, when you have different cultural backgrounds, you probably heard different music when you were 11 or 12 years old. And this may strongly determine what you like or what you don't like, what you will try to listen to, what you want. So there's a huge amount of cultural elements in the music preference, and that's very, very reproducible.
Okay. Here's another question from Ruth Mayan. Are musicality and language acquisition, the ability to acquire accents related in the brain? What contributes to being tone deaf versus having perfect pitch, environment or brain morphology?
Shall I take this?
Yes, please do, Evie.
So the brain does it, okay? Obviously, again, there's no other way. So musicality, language acquisition, the ability to acquire accents, all of that is has to do with the brain. Okay, now, what makes a person tone deaf is a difficult question. I don't think this is fully understood. There's studies into something called amusia, okay? But there's a lot of other types of psychological syndromes that are related to music. For example, one of the major researchers in this area, Robert Zatore, studied something delightfully named a congenital specific musical anhedonia, okay, which means that this is the inability of people to enjoy music, okay, which is unrelated to anything else. Okay, they enjoy gambling, they enjoy playing computer games, they enjoy all kinds of things, but they don't enjoy music. Okay, so all of these things are related to the brain in ways that we are not entirely that is not entirely clear. For example, people with this congenital specific music anhedonia sometimes are musicians. Okay, so they may be very good musicians, but they don't enjoy music. There's huge amount of connection there between things and other things, emotional brain and the sensory brain and the motor brain. I mean, these connections of music and the motor system are extremely important and are probably quite specific to humans. I mean, they're a feature of humans that is not often found in other non-human species. And we are, in a sense, we are just scratching the surface today in trying to understand what the detailed the connections.
Okay, unfortunately, I think that's all the time that we have. I know we did get some other questions we didn't get a chance to answer. If you do have specific questions, please email alumni@afhu.org and we'll try to direct them to the appropriate professor to try and get the answers for you. Professor Nelken, Professor Granot, thank you so much for a truly amazing, enlightening presentation today. Thank you everyone for joining us. This has been recorded. We will share the recording within the next couple of days with everyone. So